thanks for joining us for Fidelity Viewpoints. Make informed health plan choices. I'm Heather Hedges with Fidelity. While healthcare may not be the first thing that you think of when you think of Fidelity, we offer more than 401ks and IRAs. We're committed to your total well-being. And because healthcare is all about your most important asset, your health, we want to help educate you so you can make informed decisions as you're evaluating your healthcare options. And while it's also one of those decisions that we often don't spend a lot of time on, it can be one of the more costly decisions that we all make. We recognize medical costs can be a tremendous burden, and there may be negative emotions even tied to this topic, especially if you've had health problems or if you have family members with health problems and you've been saddled with high medical bills. With this webcast, though, we're going to arm you with information to help you make informed decisions, and that will hopefully help you spin any negative emotions that you have about the topic into positive ones to help empower you to make the best decisions for you and your family. Joining us for today's discussion are Maurice Scaife, Senior Vice President in Healthcare Solutions, and Amanda Bell Smith, Vice President of Health and Benefit Accounts. A big welcome to both of you.
Thank you for having us.
Happy to be here.
Well, guys, I would love to start by laying the foundation for everybody out there. You know, the good news is we all have options these days. There's truly something for everyone. And companies are offering more flexible benefits than ever before. So, Maurice, let's start with you and talk about step one. When is somebody eligible to enroll in a health plan?
That's right, Heather. You enroll initially as a new hire when you first get hired at the company. You make your health plan selections for you and your eligible dependents that you want to cover. Dependents are your eligible spouse, a domestic partner, or your children. You then are eligible to make changes every year during what's called an annual enrollment period. This typically happens in late fall, but you'll want to check with your employer or the health plan marketplace on the exact dates. But you don't have to wait for annual enrollment if you experience what's known as a qualifying life event. Some examples of a qualifying life event are if you change jobs, including if your spouse changes jobs or loses coverage, when you turn 26 and you get kicked off your parents' plan. And I'll use my family as an example of that. My own daughter was on my health plan until she turned 26. She was then no longer eligible to be covered under my plan and was dropped from it. So she needed to enroll in a plan that was offered by her employer. And like many of you, she had to determine at that time what was the best option for her. So she decided to go with an HSA eligible plan because it was the lowest cost option for her. But that may not be the case for everyone. We'll get into HSAs in a little bit. Another example of a qualifying life event include getting married or getting divorced or having a baby.
Well, Amanda, I know this is an important step because the plan you pick really defines what benefits you might be eligible for. So I'd like to take a moment here and dive into some of the key terms that we'll encounter when selecting, paying for, and seeking care. Run through some of the lingo, if you would, please.
Sure, Heather. And knowing the lingo is key so that you understand the plan you're picking and you pick the one that's right for you. Some of the key terms I like to highlight are premiums. This is what you pay to participate in a health plan. Think of it as the amount that comes out of your paycheck or you pay monthly to have coverage. In addition to a premium, generally there is a deductible or the yearly amount you must pay towards your covered healthcare costs before your medical plan starts to pay. If you have copays, a copay is the standard out-of-pocket expense you pay for covered services. This is the amount you pay up front at the appointment. For example, it's common to have a $25 copay for every doctor appointment. Alternatively, if you have coinsurance is the percentage you're responsible for paying after meeting your deductible. For example, even after you've met your deductible, you may be responsible for paying 20% at each doctor visit until you reach your out-of-pocket maximum. And finally, your out-of-pocket maximum is the most you could pay for your health plan, including the out-of-pocket costs such as the deductibles, the copays, and the coinsurance.
Okay, that's really helpful. Thanks, Amanda. You know, choosing a plan can be really intimidating, and it's so hard to know what's really going to be right for your specific needs and which one will cost you less when it's all said and done. Maurice, what do we need to know about that?
Sure, you're right. It can be intimidating. So there are two primary costs to think about when you're understanding your health plan. The cost of the premium you pay out of every paycheck, which Amanda touched on, and the cost of the care when you need it. Some plans load more of the cost into the premiums, and some have cheaper premiums, but you pay more out of pocket. It comes down to, do you want to pay higher premiums, but have more predictable payments at the point of care, or pay less for premiums on a regular basis, but owe more out-of-pocket expenses when you require care.
All right. Those are really important considerations, Maurice. Amanda, let's talk about the different plan options that you have to choose from.
Sure. There are a lot of different types of plans, but generally and most and popular is a HMO. It typically falls in the mid-range when it comes to the monthly premiums or the amount that's automatically deducted from your paycheck. And they come with lower deductibles. And when it comes to seeking care, you need to have a primary care physician or a PCP and then see them before getting referrals for any specialists. A PPO or a preferred provider organization, they typically have higher monthly premiums, but they offer more options when it comes to providers, and you don't need a referral to see specialists. In an HDHP or a high deductible health plan, what we like to refer to as an HSA eligible health plan, they typically come with a lower monthly premium, but have a higher deductible. And you compare the HSA eligible health plan with a health savings account. There are, as I said, other types of plans. So make sure that you refer to your plan document to understand all your plan options.
That was a fantastic overview, Amanda, and that was really helpful. Just as an example, I'll share a little bit about my own situation. I've recently changed jobs. I just went from being a TV anchor at a network affiliate to taking this job at Fidelity. I'm still on my husband's health plan, but I'm going to be looking at Fidelity's plan during annual enrollment this year. And for my family, our biggest consideration has been that we have a son with special needs. So we make most of our healthcare decisions based on his medical needs and his therapies, which are often covered by insurance. Amanda, do you have any suggestions for how I can weigh my options?
Sure, Heather. And that sounds like that's a really huge factor for you to consider. So when evaluating your choices, some things you'll want to take into consideration are the amount of health care you typically need and the details of the plan. Of course, we can't always account for those unexpected medical emergencies, but ask yourself, how many times a year do I and my family go to the doctor? Do I see a lot of specialists? How many and what types of prescriptions do I take, or how many does my family take? Often the easiest way is to look at what healthcare expenses you had last year, and that can usually be done on your carrier's website. Then you need to look at your plan options and what they cover specifically. This will help you evaluate which type of plan is right for your needs and could even save you money. Something people are not made aware of often is the difference in coverage and cost between preventative services, which are typically fully covered, versus diagnostic services, which are only partially covered or not covered at all. In your case, maybe there's a cap on the number of therapy sessions your health plan will pay for your son, and that's something you'd want to look into. And you'll want to make sure your current providers are covered by the plan. Maybe there's a niche specialist your son sees, or you have a doctor you've been going to for years who makes it worth it to stay on your current plan rather than change plans.
And Heather, we've got a really terrific tool for you. To help you figure out your specific situation and needs, we have what we call a cost comparison calculator. The calculator helps you estimate just how much money you pay in a year with each of the plan types. At the end of this webcast, you'll be able to scan a QR code to take you to the calculator and other resources. And Heather, remember, changing jobs is a qualifying life event, so you could have chosen to change your insurance at that time as well.
Well, Maurice, thanks for looking out for me. I appreciate that. I did consider that, by the way, but I was already making some nice headway into paying my out-of-pocket max, so I decided to stay with the plan that I had for another year. Amanda and Maurice, thanks so much to both of you. Great job. This was a great introduction to signing up for a health plan, and I hope it makes the process a little bit less daunting and you're able to make the right decision for you. Thanks for watching Fidelity Viewpoints, Make Informed Health Plan Choices in this chapter on finding a plan that meets your needs. I'm Heather Hegedus with Fidelity. Welcome back to Fidelity Viewpoints, Make Informed Health Plan Choices. I'm Heather Hegedus with Fidelity. Our health is one of our most valuable assets, but navigating the healthcare system can be stressful and it can be expensive. So we're going to take this time to walk you through the process of paying for healthcare and explain some of the options you have to help save some of your hard-earned money in accounts that can be used to pay for qualified medical expenses. I'm here once again with Maurice Scaife, Senior Vice President in Healthcare Solutions, and Amanda Bell-Smith, Vice President, Health and Benefit Accounts for Fidelity. Welcome back to both of you.
Thank you for having us.
I'm happy to be here again.
If you watched the last chapter, we just went through the process of getting enrolled. And now we want to get into the nitty gritty of how to use your health plan that you're paying for. So Maurice, let's start off. I was wondering if you could walk us through how to best use the insurance that we're paying for and make sure we're getting the best deal.
Would love to, Heather. So all of your different care options have different price points. The ER or emergency room being the most expensive, or your primary care physician or a walk-in clinic or telehealth being among the least expensive. And you'll want to check to see if your provider is in the network or out of the network. If it's out of the network, that may cost more. How much more depends on your plan. You can check with your carrier to determine if the provider is in network. A couple of weeks after you see the provider, look out for the explanation of benefits or EOB in the mail or on your carrier's portal or app. This explains what they will pay for the services you received and what you might have to pay out of pocket for it. If you see any possible errors, you should certainly contact the provider immediately. The provider you receive care from or service from may also send you a bill. Ensure that the copay or deductibles were applied correctly and matches your explanation of benefit. You can pay for the healthcare service a number of ways, with your HSA, health savings account, an FSA, flexible spending account, if you have either of those accounts, or with your bank account or credit card.
But I wanted to mention a recent Fidelity survey that highlighted how much healthcare affects people's personal finances, which is again why Fidelity is interested in this topic. The survey found most respondents to that survey are tapping their personal bank accounts to pay for healthcare and using credit cards. But it also found that they're also taking advantage of HSAs, which we'll get into in a moment. What's troubling is that some of the people who responded said they're even taking out loans to pay for healthcare. Another good point here is that many doctors and hospitals actually offer payment plans that they can take advantage of to help spread the payments out over time. And sometimes you can ask for a discount if you're paying cash at the time of service.
Yeah, I think a lot of people don't know that, Amanda, but you actually can get discounted healthcare. There is such a thing if you pay in full sometimes. In that survey that we just showed, by the way, almost a third of respondents said they use HSAs to help pay for healthcare, at least in part. So let's dive deeper into that option now, Amanda. Can you explain some of the benefits of an HSA?
Sure. HSA, or health savings account, is a benefit you're eligible for when you enroll in an HSA eligible plan, also called a high deductible health plan. Your plan has to meet certain deductibles to be eligible. For 2023, it is $1,500 for individual coverage and $3,000 for family coverage. And you can't be covered by another health plan, such as Medicare, TRICARE, or be a dependent on someone else's tax return. HSAs allow you to save and pay for your qualified medical expenses for you, your spouse, domestic partner, if you claim them as a tax dependent, and your dependents. You can use your HSA to pay for qualified medical expenses like contact lenses, Band-Aids, some over-the-counter medications, but also for prescriptions, insulin, or even to pay copays and coinsurance.
No, absolutely. And Amanda, let's emphasize that an HSA plan is tax advantaged every step of the way. We like to say an HSA has triple tax advantage. That means there are no taxes when, one, you put your money in the account pre-tax, which means you don't pay income taxes on those contributions. Two, as your money potentially grows, you don't pay capital gains taxes. And three, spending HSA money is tax-free when you use them to pay for qualified medical expenses.
And it's flexible. You can adjust the amount you're contributing at any time, not just during annual enrollment, which is a good way to budget how much you want to save towards your healthcare expenses. You can even put it in just the amount you need when you need it. You're paying for qualified medical expenses anyways when you buy contacts or glasses, so why not save on taxes while you're doing it?
That's right. And something viewers may not know, you're eligible to open an HSA as long as you're enrolled in a high deductible plan, regardless of whether your employer offers it or not. You can open one through a financial services company like Fidelity. Also, the money is yours to keep. There's also no expiration date on the money you put aside. And if you change employers, you could take it with you. And you have the option to invest the money for future potential growth.
Well, you know, some people might assume, though, if you do have a lot of medical expenses, like my own family does, because I shared my son received several kinds of autism-related therapies, that an HSA-eligible health plan might not be the right option, though, even though an HSA is tempting. So, Amanda, is there any truth to that assumption?
Heather, that's a great question. It is often the reason I hear why folks don't enroll in an HSA-eligible health plan. The fear of catastrophic diagnosis or high usage of healthcare or prescriptions can be scary. I can certainly understand and relate. 8 years ago, I was a normal, healthy mother of a three-year-old, and I was diagnosed with stage 2 breast cancer. It was completely out of the blue and obviously a shock to my family. I'd never given the out-of-pocket maximum for our plan a lot of thought. We had selected the plan prior to my diagnosis for the low monthly premiums, our doctors were in network, and we had the ability to save in an HSA. But once we understood better what my treatment plan would be, the chemo, the surgeries, radiation, I did pause for a moment and wonder how we would pay those expenses. You go into that having no idea what expense could be, but just wanting the best treatment. Thankfully, we had a medical plan with an out-of-pocket maximum, an OOPM, that I knew we could cover, and I had an HSA to help offset those out-of-pocket costs. Not all medical plan coverage is the same, but there is an out-of-pocket maximum that you will pay in any given year, and having savings in an HSA can help when the unexpected occurs. For us, the HSA-eligible health plan was the best financial choice, even with a major diagnosis.
Yeah, that's right. But you could be enrolled in a non-high-deductible PPO, as Heather is, or in an HMO, because your provider is part of that HMO, and you could pair that HMO or that PPO with a flexible spending account.
Okay, that's valuable information, Maurice. And Amanda, we are just so thrilled that you are doing better. And thank you so much for sharing something so personal with our audience. Let's talk about FSAs as well. Just to give you a little bit of an example here, when I was first starting out in the real world, I had just gotten off my parents' health plan, much like Maurice's daughter, and I set some money aside in a healthcare FSA. And then I was so busy with my new job that I forgot about it. And guess what happened? I lost it, right, at the end of the year. So I called HR and I said, you know, I need my money back. And they said, sorry, you don't use it, you lose it. And that was just an awful feeling because I wasn't making a lot of money. It was my first job. So I know some FSAs allow you to roll the account balance over. But in my case, it wasn't an option. And I learned the hard way. I had to use it within the plan year. With an HSA, though, you have more flexibility. So I was wondering if, Maurice, if you could kind of lay out for us some more of the key differences there between an FSA and an HSA.
Absolutely. Would love to. First of all, Heather, don't feel bad. We've all been there with the use it or lose it concept of FSAs. So let's talk about HSAs first. HSAs and FSAs have some things in common, and they also have some differences. Both offer contributions that are exempt from federal income tax, and in most cases, exempt from state income taxes, and both may be used to pay for qualified medical expenses. But as you said, there are differences. A healthcare flexible spending account, an FSA, is money you set aside and plan to spend in that year. You can contribute and save pre-tax dollars and then spend them in the same year on qualified medical expenses. Unlike an HSA, generally, as you learned the hard way, Heather, you may need to use all of the money saved in an FSA in that same year you contributed it. There are plans that allow provisions to allow it to roll over to the next year, or there may be a grace period. You should definitely check with your plan to see if they have either one of those provisions.
Say, for example, if you have an upcoming surgery or maybe a child that needs braces next year, you can plan ahead and set that money aside in a healthcare flexible spending account and get the pre-tax benefits. Ultimately, you're going to be spending that money and you know how much you're looking to spend. Typically, contributions to a flexible spending account are set up during annual enrollment, so you can't change or adjust the amount you put in the account in the middle of the year.
Another question, can you get both an HSA and an FSA?
Actually, the answer is yes. Although if you have an HSA, you cannot also have a traditional healthcare FSA. However, you may have access to enroll into what's called a limited purpose FSA, also known as an LP FSA, along with your HSA. A limited purpose FSA is offered through your employer and can be used to pay for qualified medical expenses such as dental and vision. But unlike an HSA, you may lose any money you don't spend from a limited purpose FSA at the end of the year.
Okay, some important distinctions there between HSAs and FSAs to consider. Thank you to both of you. Hopefully you now better understand the resources you can use to your advantage to save your hard-earned money pre-tax to help pay for healthcare needs. And hopefully you take a lesson from me and you learn the rules of each account so you don't lose some of your own money like I did. For Fidelity, I'm Heather Hegedus, and thank you for watching Fidelity Viewpoints, Make Informed Healthcare Choices, Paying for Healthcare. We'll be right back. I'm Heather Hedges with Fidelity. You're watching Fidelity Viewpoints, Make Informed Healthcare Choices. And today we've been walking you through how to select your health plan and how to pay for healthcare expenses wisely. You might not think of healthcare as an issue that a financial services company like Fidelity would be talking about, but healthcare can be a huge chunk of people's expenses, and it has the potential to impact your personal finances greatly. But there's also another reason that Fidelity wants to help educate folks about this topic as well, and that's because you can also use health savings accounts to invest. So to talk about that today, I'm joined again by Maurice Scaife, Senior Vice President in Healthcare Solutions, and Amanda Bell Smith, Vice President of Health and Benefit Accounts, to explain how it all works.
Thanks again for having us.
Happy to be here.
All right, so let's jump right into the topic of HSAs. And it sounds like one of the benefits of an HSA is that the money never expires until you spend it. So Amanda, can you start us off by talking about why that's such a big deal?
Sure. There are a couple of reasons why this is so important. One is that if you're fortunate, you may go years without major healthcare costs. And during that time, you can save and invest the money in your HSA from when you need it later. Take a 26-year-old who opens an HSA. They may not have many expenses outside of their typical annual checkups, possibly some glasses, contacts, maybe a couple of additional appointments a year. If they keep contributing to their HSA, by the time they need it, they have been able to save the money to help defray for those expenses later in life, like having a baby. And if you are able to save the money long-term, you can also invest it. The reason this is so important is Fidelity's research shows that an individual retiring will spend over $150,000 on healthcare during retirement, which we realize is a lot of money to plan for. Not only can you save that money for years, but you can invest all or some of those dollars so you have the potential opportunity for future growth.
Remember, though, it's also okay if you do have to spend the money in your HSA, even all of it. That's what it's there for. You will still get the tax benefit when you contribute those dollars to the account and when you take that money out to pay for qualified medical expenses.
Okay, well, let's just say that I do have money left over in my HSA. How can I use that to invest? Maurice?
Sure. At Fidelity, your HSA is a brokerage account, which gives you the option to use the cash that you contribute to buy investments, such as mutual funds. If you invest unused money for a period of time, say 20 years, you could accumulate much more than keeping it in just cash. Even $1,000 a year could help you over an extended period of time. It might seem risky to invest your healthcare savings, but you don't have to go all in. You can leave some of your money in cash, so you have immediate access to it for paying for healthcare expenses now, and invest the rest of it for future needs. One way to start is by setting what we refer to as a cash target. Think of this as the amount you'll need this year to cover your deductible and any out-of-pocket costs. After you've met that cash target, you can invest the rest of the funds in the account. And if you've invested some of your funds, you can also sell your investments and have cash to pay for qualified medical expenses.
And remember, investing is an option, which means you make the choice on which investments are right for you. Whether you'd like to choose and manage your own investments or let Fidelity do it for you, we have options that will work for you.
That sounds like a great opportunity to really grow our money. But do we really need that much? You know, what happens if I don't spend all of that money? Can I spend it on anything else?
Yeah, sure, Heather. At age 65, you can use your HSA like any other retirement account. Remember, the funds are yours to keep, and you can use them how you like. And you can use your HSA for anything. There's no penalty involved, but you'll have to pay income tax on your withdrawals. Unless you use them for qualified medical expenses, then they're still tax-free. Also, if you paid for qualified medical expenses yourself out of pocket over the years, you can then reimburse yourself down the line for those expenses. But it's recommended to keep receipts or your EOB's explanation of benefits in case the IRS does decide to audit. Fidelity issues an annual retiree healthcare cost estimate and found that a 65-year-old person retiring this year can expect to spend a considerable amount of money on healthcare and medical expenses throughout retirement. And the current estimate amount is right now on the screen.
Wow. So let me get this straight. So you're saying you can then use any money left over in your HSA for anything you want. You don't have to use it for medical expenses. So you might even have the flexibility to use it for non-qualified medical expenses in retirement, even for something like something personal, like a trip around the world.
You can.
All right. I didn't know that. Well, also, let's say now I'm in retirement and I'm thinking about getting on Medicare at 65, of course, Medicare being the government-sponsored healthcare coverage. What do I need to know, Maurice, about using an HSA after I enroll in Medicare?
When most people think about healthcare and retirement, they think about getting on Medicare at age 65. But there are a lot of other costs in retirement, some of which Medicare might not cover, including premiums, deductibles, co-payments, and some prescription medications. That's where your HSA can help, to pay for expenses that Medicare might not cover. One important point to remember, once you enroll in Medicare, you can no longer contribute to an HSA. However, the money in your HSA account is still yours. It's time to start using it to pay for qualified medical expenses or other retirement expenses. There are some complexities on how you use it, so it's always best to consult with your tax professional.
Maurice, that is so true. As my father has now come into retirement and has been prescribed a medication that actually costs over $500 a month, if he had funds in an HSA, he could have used those funds to cover the cost that Medicare doesn't cover for that prescription. The problem is, there's no generic for that prescription, and he's on a fixed income, and as you can imagine, that actually really eats into his monthly expenses.
Oh, I must. It's too bad an HSA wasn't available to your father, Amanda, as an option when he was working, and now, as Maurice just explained, it's not an option because he's already enrolled in Medicare. Okay, so we talked about how my HSA can be used to help save for healthcare and retirement, but Amanda, how do I determine how much I put into an HSA versus how much I put into my retirement savings, such as a 401k if my employer offers one?
Sure, it can be hard to figure out how to divvy up your limited funds for savings. So to start with, we suggest, if you can, contributing enough to your 401k to get your full employer match, if your employer offers one. At the same time, set aside enough money in your HSA to cover this year's medical expenses. If you don't know how much that will be, either your deductible or your out-of-pocket maximum is a good place to start. And also remember, you can contribute as you incur medical expense using our HSA on the go feature, as opposed to having funds deducted from your paycheck. If you watch this chapter through to the end, we'll have a QR code that will take you to a site that helps explain many of the topics we covered today, including our HSA on the go feature. Then next, focus on maxing out your HSA contribution if you can. That's because you can use this money in retirement and you get the triple tax advantage we've talked about. If you have more money to put away once you max out your HSA contribution, then contribute more to your 401k up to its max.
Fantastic suggestions, both of you. And hopefully we've helped you find ways to save money on something we all need, healthcare. And in this chapter, we hope you gained a greater understanding of how you can invest your healthcare money for the future. So once again, a big thank you to Maurice and Amanda for explaining the entire process for us. And just a suggestion, you might want to bookmark this webcast. And as you go through annual enrollment, you can come back to the chapters to refresh your memory on what you need to consider. Also, we know we gave you a lot of information today, but only you can decide what is best for your own personal situation. So we have a great resource to help with that. On our website, we have resources like a simple calculator that helps you understand which plan is right for you and the potential growth of your HSA savings. Just scan the QR code on your screen right now. And remember, you can always reach out to us by calling us or visiting our website. I'm Heather Hegedus. Take good care.